All right, welcome everybody to the Algebra 1AB 6.1 to 6.4 review video. So this will take you through quite a bit of our review. Just remember that part of this test will be calculator, part of it will be non-calculator, so I'll be sure to point out which problems you will be allowed calculators on as we go through this. All right, so the first part, our simplifying, this was our section 6.1 notes. Definitely a good thing to go back and revisit before taking this test. There's a lot of properties. We spent 4 days on it, so that would definitely be a thing to look over beforehand. On the test itself, this section here, this simplify section, will be calculator allowed. So if you want to make a little note there, that's kind of a nice thing to know. But we'll go through. We notice our answer should only have positive exponents as we go through this simplifying work. So I'm going to go through kind of quickly just to kind of illustrate what's going on. But if you want more detail, you can go back and take a look at the individual lesson videos or your notes packet. So problem number one, I've got a coefficient of 5 times x squared times another coefficient of 5 times x to the fourth. So the coefficients are 5s. Those are regular numbers multiplied in. I'm going to group those together. And then I'm going to group together my factors that have a base of x and then a different power. So this 5 times 5, I can multiply those together. Those are just normal numbers. They're not bases, so coefficients can multiply here. The x to the second times x to the fourth, I've got the same base. This is 2 x's multiplied together, and I bring in 4 more. I'm going to add those exponents together to get a final answer of 25 x to the sixth. And my little catchphrase in class was, when in doubt, expand it out. If you wanted to, you could expand this as 5 times x times x times 5 times x times x times x times x, and that'll help you group those things together as well. Number two is the same idea, except now we have 3 factors multiplied together, 2 times b to the fifth times 4 times b to the second times 4 times b to the second. So I'm going to group together my coefficients, those regular numbers, not exponents, but that don't have any powers on them. So the 2 and the 4 and the 4, I'm going to group that multiplication first. And then I've got a bunch of terms with a base b, don't I? I've got a b to the fifth, a b to the second, and another b to the second power. 2 times 4 is 8, times another 4 is 32. And then I've got a whole bunch of b's, don't I? A swarm. I've got 5 and then 2 more and then 2 more all multiplied together. I'm going to add those exponents together, b to the ninth power. For problem number 3, this one's tricky because it looks like 3 times 3 times 3. It kind of looks like those coefficients from up above, but if I look closely, those 3s are actually bases. So for this one, I'm going to keep my base. Remember, we're going to leave the bases alone. And here, I've got 8 threes multiplied together, and then I multiply in 3 more, and then 7 more is really just adding up the exponents like in 1 and 2, but this is all happening on a base that is a number. It's the number 3. So my final answer here is going to be 3 to the 18th power, and that's where we're done. All right, problem number 4. Here for this one, I've got a complicated base, 4m to the 3rd to the 4th power. So if I think about this, this would be 4 times m to the third, and I see that 4m to the third 4 times, meaning I've got 4 multiplied in 4 times, and I've also got m to the third multiplied in 4 times. Now, we kind of called this Oprah's favorite things as we were going through. When there's a complicated base and we've got a product inside, in this case 4 times m to the third, everything that's a part of that product receives the power that's on that base. So 4 to the 4th, we're going to leave that one alone, right? Just positive exponents is our only requirement. And then m to the 3rd to the 4th, here's our power to a power. I'm going to leave my base alone, but I'm going to multiply those exponents 3 times 4. There's our answer. All right, for problem number 5, this one's a little bit easier. Here I've got a base of 2 to the 3rd power to the 4th power. So my base of 2 stays the same. Oop, I meant to change colors there. My base of 2 stays the same. And then I've got 3 times 4, again, power to a power. That one, I can probably just write down the answer and I'm good. All right, and then number 6, very much like we did in problems 1 and 2, I've got coefficient of 6 times y times a coefficient of 3 times y to the 10th. So I've got some coefficients, 6 times 3, and then I've got some base y things. I've got a y with an unwritten first power times a y to the 10th power. the coefficients I can multiply, and then for my base y things, let's make that a single base y. I've got 1 and 10 more all multiplied together. That's 11 y's multiplied together. All right, for the next one, here we've got a lot happening. Now, there will be a couple on your test that do have some complicated thing, maybe two or three of them that kind of look like this number 7 here and number 9. But we try to keep it pretty straightforward where you can show us a property or two, at the most 3 from this section. So let's take a look. It's just a matter of grouping. I've got a hidden coefficient of negative 1 times x to the negative 4th times y to the 2nd times another coefficient of 3 times y to the 4th. So here, let's look. Our coefficients were a negative 1 and a 3. And then I've got a base x term that's x to the negative 4th, and there's no other base x factors multiplied in. Then I've got a y to the 2nd and a y to the 4th. I can multiply together my coefficients. I've got x to the negative 4th, and I've got y to the, okay, here it's not power to a power, so I'm just going to add those exponents together. And this is almost a perfect answer, except we want only positive exponents. So see how this base of x has a negative power? I need to use the reciprocal property just with that. The negative 3 and the y to the 6th are fine, but the x to the 4th, to write it with a positive exponent, I need to take its reciprocal, move it down to a denominator. All right, problem number 8. Here I've got a base of k to the negative 1st to the negative 2nd. It's a power to a power, so I'm going to multiply those exponents together. Negative 1 times negative 2 is positive 2. Boy, why can't they all be like that, like number 5? Pretty nice. For number 9, here it's division, but I do notice there's some same bases happening here. So let's see. I'm going to kind of group together. I've got a 2 over a 4, and let's just expand everything out. I like to see things cancel because powers mean multiplying and a fraction means dividing. It's nice to see when multiplying and dividing cancel each other out. So I've got a 2 times n times n times p times p times p, and in the denominator, I want to kind of go in the same order. So I've got 4 times n times n times just 1p, p to the 1st. And let's see what cancels out there. If I first look at my coefficients here, I've got 2 divided by 4. Just like we could multiply the coefficients together, we did it up here in number 6. We can also simplify division. So 2 divided by 4 is going to be the same thing as 1 divided by 2. Now let's look at our base n things. So I've got n multiplied into the top twice and multiplied into the bottom twice. It's the same thing being multiplied and divided. Those cancel out. All right, I've also got 1p that cancels out, but there's 2 extras in the top. So I've got p to the 2nd, and then nothing else for p terms. So let's clean up that answer for the very end here. Across the top, 1 times p to the 2nd is p to the 2nd. Across the bottom, 2 times 1 is 2. Okay, and then finally here, number 10. Here we've got coefficient of 2 times n to the negative 4th times n to the negative 3rd. My coefficients, there's really just one of them. But my base n things, I've got n to the 4th and n to the 3rd multiplying together. Again, not power to a power, so I'm just going to add those exponents together. I get 2n to the negative 1st. Now, I can't leave my answer that way because we can't end up with negative exponents. This n has a negative power on it, and so that needs to be taken as a reciprocal. So I've got 2 over n to the 1st, and if it's a first power, it doesn't even really need to be written. That one's done. So there is the first section. That's coming out of section 6.1. All right, the next problems, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16. You can see for 15 and 16, we say without a calculator. All of this stuff is section 6.2. if we're looking at like a lesson to go back and revisit, and all of this stuff is non-calculator, so it'll be on the non-calculator page of your test. So the first task is just to rewrite an expression where we have a base with a fraction or a rational exponent. And just remember, this is telling us a root and a power. So I've got the 4th root of 46 to the 1st power, or just the 4th root of 46, since we don't need to write a first power. So radical form is where we have that radical symbol as a part of our answer. And we're just rewriting. We're not solving or simplifying anything, just a rewriting. For number 12, it's the same thing. Here we've got a 29, and that has a rational exponent. So I'm going to write that as a radical. I've got a seventh root and a fourth power, and that one's done. These are some of the fastest problems on the whole test. For the next one, number 13, here I've got a third root of 13, and I don't see a power, so I can assume that that's a first power there that I just don't see. Well, that 13 is going to become a base, and I know that the root is the denominator of that power that's rational, that fraction exponent. 13 to the 1/3 power, and that one's done. For problem 14 here, I've got 19 under a radical, and it's a fifth root, but it's also got a second power on it. So that's a 2/5 power. A very, very simple pattern, but hopefully we got this down. A lot of times students will mix up the order of the numbers because you want to read from left to right. Just remember the root goes on the bottom. Okay, now lastly, you will be given a list of perfect squares and perfect cubes as you work. So like you'll be given something that says like squares, 1, 4, 9, 16, 25, 36, 49, 64, 81, 100, dot, dot, dot. And you'll also be given cubes, 1, 8, 27, 64, 125, 216, dot, dot, dot. All right, and so our job is to use the fact that roots undo powers to simplify this without a calculator. So for number 15, there's no number written in the radical, which a lot of times means a 1 or a 0. But if this is an empty radical, it's implied that it is a square root. It undoes a square or a second power. So I'm going to look at my list of perfect squares, and I see that 100 is on there. You'll also have a multiplication table that you can use, so it's done non-calculator. But we quickly find that the square root of 100 is the same thing as 10 to the second. So cancel out the root and the power. The answer there is just 10. And we've evaluated it. We've gotten a number for an answer. Now, it is possible, too, that if I just asked you what's the square root of 100, you don't have to show this work. If you just know that that is 10, you're able to just put that answer and be done with it. Okay, and then for number 16, here I've got a third root of 27. So as I look at my perfect cubes, 1, 8, 27 is the third perfect cube. That means 27 is the same thing as 3 cubed. And again, we've rewritten that 27 so that we can see a root and a power cancel out. The answer is just 3. The radical gets canceled by the power underneath. All right, so there's a good glimpse at the non-calculator work or some of the non-calculator work that's going to show up. All right, 17 and 18, these will be on the calculator portion of the test, so you are able to help out with those. But we've learned a couple different function families at this point throughout the course. So we have exponential or linear functions, or maybe it's neither of those two. For number 17, I take a look. I see a lot of stuff, but I really just want to see where is x. So x, my input, notice that it is an exponent for my input. That tells me that this is an exponential function. And that's all we have to put for an answer, is the word exponential. For number 18 here, if I take a look at my x, see how that's kind of falling in line with y equals mx plus b? There's no powers, x isn't in a denominator, nothing too fancy, there's no radicals or like x isn't a power or anything. This kind of formatting shows us that this is a linear function. Just a plain x and a plain y. Okay, numbers 19 and 20, you will have two problems that have you graph without a calculator. This is section 6.3 work that we're doing. And take a look at the instructions. They're going to help you out. I think we also actually print a blank little table of values, like a blank t-chart for you to fill in. So for exponentials, remember, we want to choose numbers that are very close to zero. And then we can figure out what the outputs are going to be along the way. Okay, so my advice to you is to start with zero and then work your way positive to get a feel for the graph. So to find my output, I'm going to start with the input of 0. Y is equal to 2 to the 0th power. Well, anything to the 0th power is 1. So I'm going to start with the point 0, comma 1. Then next, when I plug in a 1, I'm going to do this one in green. Y equals 2 to the 1st power. 2 to the 1st power is 2. So I've got the point 1, comma 2 for the next point. Okay, and then the next one, we'll do this one in black. Y equals 2 to the 2nd power. Again, every time I'm just replacing that x power with whatever's in my x column. 2 to the 2nd power is 4. So 2, comma 4. And then I go back and I take a look at the negative powers. So y equals 2 to the negative 1st. Well, that means a reciprocal. It's 1 over 2 to the 1st. It's 1 half. So at negative 1, I'm at 1 half for the height of that point. Okay, and then the last one, y equals 2 now with a negative 2nd power, that's 1 over 2 to the 2nd. It's 1 fourth. And so we can see that this graph, if we're going to connect it all together, it levels off on the left-hand side, and then it bends its way through, and it will race off to the right. And that's all we're looking for. Do you know how to evaluate the exponents by hand? And then can you turn that into something that resembles the shape of an exponential function? Racing up and leveling off. Let's try number 20 here, x and y. I'll try and color code these a little bit better. I'm still going to choose the x values negative 2, negative 1, 0, 1, and 2. Again, start off with, if I were you, I would start with the 0 and go from there. So here, y equals a base of 1 fourth to a 0th power. Well, anything that's not 0 raised to a 0 power is going to output a 1. So again, I have 0, comma 1. Next, if I have y equals 1 fourth to the 1st power, well, that's going to be pretty nice, won't it? Because anything to the 1st power is the base. So at 1, my height is 1 fourth. And then at 2, y equals 1 fourth to the 2nd. Well, when we have a fraction that as a base that has a power, it's 1 to the 2nd over 4 to the 2nd, right? Kind of like Oprah's favorite things, each part of that base gets the 2nd power on it. So 1 16th is very, very close to the x-axis. If I plug in a negative 1, y equals 1 fourth to the negative 1, well, that negative 1st power, remember, that's a reciprocal. So it changes the base from 1 to the 1st over 4 to the 1st. It flips it. 4 to the 1st over 1 to the 1st. It's just 4 over 1. And lastly, y equals 1 fourth to the negative 2nd. This one does a reciprocal as well, changes that base to a 4 over 1, but it also applies a 2nd power. So at negative 2, we're all the way up with a height of 16. And so this graph levels off towards the right, and it races up towards the left, like so. And that concludes the non-calculator work. So everything else, you're going to be allowed to use a calculator to help you out with. So 21 and 22, these are examples. You can see they're a little bit more complicated. This is also section 6.3, but this is where you'll be allowed to use a calculator on the test. So I'm going to pull up my calculator here. You'll still have an XY table of values to fill in. We're still going to use negative 2, negative 1, 0, 1, and 2. But I'm just going to go through and show you how I would do that one at a time. So for number 21, I've got 1 third. So I'm going to do 1 divided by 3 in parentheses times 7. And then right here underneath clear is the caret key. So I'm going to do to the negative 2nd. And since I can use the calculator, I can just go right in order. I don't have to start with 0. And you can see it's 0.0068. And we can just copy that decimal and round it a little bit, because we're going to have to kind of estimate where that decimal is on our graph anyway. Then I'll just go through and do the next one. 1 third times 7 to the negative 1st. And this is 0.0476. So I'm going to call that 0.05. Okay, and then the next one, I've got the calculator, I might as well use it. Although to the zeroth power, we probably don't really have to do a calculator on this one, but you can see I get 0.3 repeating. Try to make that show up a little bit better for you. So I'll put 0.33. Next, 1/3 times 7 to the first power. Again, you got the calculator, might as well use it. And that's 2.3 repeating, so 2.33. And then 1 divided by 3 times 7 to the second. Most commonly what students will forget to do is they'll forget to hit that caret key, so that they'll just be doing like 7 times 2 or 72 or something. They won't make sure that they're entering a power for their x value. Here we got 16.33. All right, so let's plot those points and see what we look like at negative 2. Boy, 0.007 is barely off the x-axis at all. Negative 1, not much better. At 0, here I'm only at 0.33, so I'm not even halfway up to that first line. At 1, I'm at 2.33, so here we can see the graph starting to race upwards. And then at 2, I'm all the way up at 16.33. That's what the graph should be looking like. It levels off on the left side and races up on the right-hand side. That's a really good example of what an exponential graph looks like. All right, let's try 23. Same idea. All right, so we'll clear that out. Here I've got 2 times 3 to the x. So 2 times 3 to the negative second gives me 0.22. So at negative 2, I'm again barely up off the x-axis. Next, I've got 2 times 3 to the negative first, and that's 0.67. So here at negative 1, I'm about 2/3 of the way up to that first line. 2 times 3 to the zeroth power. You can see it goes quite fast. We're really happy to have the calculator helping us out here. Next, 2 times 3 to the first, which is 6. This one's a little bit nicer. We're getting cleaner outputs, aren't we? I feel a lot better plotting these points. And lastly, 2 times 3 to the second is 18. But you can see each time I'm typing in the function itself, 2 times 3 with a power on it, and I'm just changing that power to be my x value. So 2, 18 is our last entry. There we go. Now that's a pretty rough line because I'm drawing on a tablet here. It's not as nice as I would hope to have made it, but there you go. All right, now the final 4 problems here, they kind of go in sets of 2. This is section 6.4, which is our exponential growth and decay. So just remember, you will be given this. You'll be given this as like a guide, but you're going to have to know, do I choose the plus or the minus sign? What is R? What is A? What is T? To answer these questions. So for the first part of this number 23, we're asked, write a function that represents the cases of disease X after T years. Okay, let's go back and read the information at the top. Due to stricter sanitation laws, the number of cases of disease X is expected to decrease, that's a key word, by 8%. Over the next 6 years. The current number of cases of disease X is 786. All right, so I'm going to start off with my Y equals. The A value is the current number, or the current population, or the current account, whatever we're dealing with. It's the starting amount, and here it's 786. Then I've got 1, and they say decrease, so it's 1 minus the rate. And 8% as a rate, I'm going to want to write that as 0.08, like 8 cents would show up on a cash register, right? So 8 cents out of a dollar, just take that 8% and divide it by 100 to get the decimal if we want. And they tell me not to use the 6 years, but they say to call it just T years. So we need a power there, but we're just going to leave that as a T for now. And then number 24, what will be the estimated number of cases? We're going to take what we had set up in 23 and they tell us to plug in a 4 for the T. So even though we see 6 years up here, none of our questions asked us about 6 years. They asked us about T years and about 4 years. So here I've got something that I'm going to go ahead and calculate right now. Let's go ahead and see what that looks like. I'm just going to type it in exactly how I see it. 700, and I think I typed that backwards, 86, yep, parentheses 1 minus 0.08 to the fourth. So we got 563.08. They say to round it to the nearest whole number. So 563, if it's 0.0 something, that's not enough to round this up to 564. So we would say 563 cases for our final answer there. Let's take a look at the last one here. Based on sales of the new version of the game Mystify, it is anticipated that current online membership, that it currently is 8,070, will increase by 11% each month for the next year. 25 here, so we got Y equals, let's see, A, my current amount is 8,070 times 1. Okay, do I want plus or minus? They say increase, so plus, what would 11% be as a decimal? 0.11 if I divide 11 by 100, and they're telling us to use just T for our time going by. In this case, it's months. That one's done. For number 26, here I'm going to take that formula that I've set up here, and they say after 6 months, so I'm going to plug in a 6 for my number of months, T. Let's go ahead and calculate that. So here we got 8,070 times 1 plus 0.11 to the sixth. And when I hit enter, I get 15,094. And again, 94, there's a 0.2 afterwards, so it doesn't round it up to 15,095. We would just stop it right there at 94. Okay, and then that's the number of members. All right, and as with all of our other reviews that we've done so far this year, we're going to close things off with a couple of SAT-style problems. You'll have one of these on your test as well. Oop, I noticed a little typo right there. The word should only has one L in it, so I apologize for that. The stock price of one share of a certain company is worth $360 today. A stock analyst believes that the stock will lose 28% of its value each week for the next 3 weeks. The analyst uses the equation V equals 360 R to the T to model the value V of the stock after T weeks. What value should the analyst use for R? So this looks very much, take a look, V equals 360 times R to the T. Isn't that eerily similar to Y equals A times 1 minus R to the T power? It's just they're calling all of this 1 minus R that we use. They're just calling that whole thing R. Okay, so what value should the analyst use for R? So we want to know what this entire 1, what we would call 1 minus R, okay, they mentioned lose 28%. So in this case, the rate for ours is 28%, which is 0.28 as a decimal. So we would be using Y equals 360 times 1 minus 0.28 to the T. And what does 1 minus 0.28 give us? Well, Y equals 360 times, if I just use a calculator for that, that's 0.72 to the T. And you can see how much that looks like the formula that this stock analyst is using. Correct answer is C. Okay, and our final problem here, if A to the negative 1/2 power equals X, what is A in terms of X? Okay, so I'm trying to solve this thing for A. A to the negative 1/2 power equals X. Well, let's think. I can treat both sides of the equation equally. I'm actually going to show you two different ways to do this problem. If I want to solve for A, what would undo a negative 1/2 for a power? Well, if I could take a negative second power on both sides, then my power to a power on A would leave me with A to the first, and I get x to the negative second. So a would equal 1 over x squared. The answer is B. Another way to do this one, and I'll show this in pink, because we haven't really done powers on both sides to solve before. That's kind of a clever solution. I would imagine that a lot of you would see this. I've got a 1 half power, which means a square root, and it's negative. So this is like a square root of a that's been flipped into a denominator. And so what do we do if we want to solve for this a? Well, I've got 1 divided by square root of a. Let's multiply both sides by square root of a. 1 equals x times the square root of a. And if I want to get to a, I've got to divide away x from both sides. So 1 over x is equal to the square root of a. And then lastly, what undoes roots? Roots and powers undo each other, so we would put a second power on both sides to cancel out the root. 1 squared over x squared is equal to just a now. So we still get that answer of B, but using some solving steps that we're probably a little bit more familiar with. All right, so again, nice little glimpse at how the stuff that we're learning is helping us out. Remember, these are junior level SAT problems, so you're kind of seeing how much of this class is preparing you for this kind of big test happening your junior year. You're setting yourselves up pretty nicely. That does it for this review guide video. Happy studying, everybody. Thanks for watching.